Hey, I'm Janek Gwizdala, it's video-basedlessons.tv, and I have a couple of tips, two tips for you on playing standards. We are about to start a 12-week course at video-basedlessons.tv all about jazz standard repertoire, which is, I put out a survey, and that was the overwhelming favorite topic of choice that people wanted me to make a course on. So we're about to get started with that, and I wanted to give you a little preview, a little kind of look inside what we're going to be talking about. And take a look at a couple of the ideas, a couple of the simple ideas that I really dig when it comes to being more confident with this material, memorizing more tunes, and you know, like the whole thing of being able to survive a jam session. What's the repertoire that you need to know in order to go out there and kind of not fall flat on your face? I know I've done it many times, fall flat on my face and not know a bunch of tunes. So those are some of the things we're looking at in the 12-week course, specifically regarding jazz standards and standard repertoire like that. So before we get started with this lesson, I need you to go right here and subscribe to the YouTube channel, because I'm always putting out these free videos. So right above my finger right here, you can subscribe to the YouTube channel. And if you want to come and join us on the 12-week course, click the link below. We're running a special offer on quarterly memberships all of this week. So if you click the link below, you can go and make use of that, and you can come and join us and check out what this entire 12-week course is about. So to get to the two tips, the first tip being I like to find similarities. Two things that I think are super important about any repertoire, actually. But specifically this standard repertoire that we're talking about, it's similarities between songs and how much common information is used between songs. We're starting our first week of the course with Blue Bossa, Joe Henderson's song Blue Bossa. Assignments I'm setting all the students is you've got to learn the melody. Now that's not just for Blue Bossa. To me, that's for everything. That's for, you know, doesn't matter if you're playing Blue Bossa, all the things you are, Lush Life, you know, any tune, you should really know the melody. And my suggestion for this, and the reason it's great to know the melody is, especially if everyone in the band knows the melody as well, that's really important. If you feel you're getting lost, you can kind of hook on and identify that melody as soon as you hear it. So if somebody else feels you're getting lost in the band, or if you know the melody really well and you feel somebody isn't perhaps on the same page, or they're in the wrong place, or they've lost the form or something, you can play a simple phrase of the melody and pull that person in. That is the importance to me of knowing the melody and being able to not only police yourself and stay on form and stay in the right place in the tune and be able to walk bass lines and play melodies and play solos, but to be able to help other people out around you and to be able to communicate better, to make sure you're really all on the same page. As soon as you hear, immediately you know, wow, that's the top of the form, because I know that part of the melody and I'm right there. And within a bar, maybe even a beat, you can fall straight back into the right place in the form if you get lost. And it's not just for if you get lost. That's probably not my main focus, is trying not to get lost when I get on a gig. My main focus, especially with the melody, especially if I'm going to be playing solos, is to reference that melody. Simply referencing the melody, embellishing the melody when I start to play a solo. And there's no reason why that can't be used when you're walking bass lines as well. Just using that octave that occurs in the melody. Just walking down from E flat, that's actually the melody. So your bass line when you're walking it might actually be the melody itself. So all of these things are interconnected. So that's my first tip, is always learning the melody. And you know, I'm sure you've heard people say learn the melody, it's really important. So the tip and the idea is really not just about learning the melody, but knowing what you can do by knowing the melody. Like I said, helping people that get lost, being able to latch on when somebody else helps you out to find the form again. That's really important. That's huge. And of course, the soloing thing as well, being able to play melodically and kind of reference the tune you're playing. The other tip, I guess, for this lesson, and the other kind of idea and something we're working on throughout the course of this 12-week program, are the similarities between tunes. And so much of jazz standard repertoire is built up on 2-5-1s, on a very simple. Very simple cadence, 2-5-1. It's such a popular thing, and you have tunes which range from the kind of, I was gonna say, really complicated. Once you get into it, it's not that complicated, but it's definitely more dense, like a moment's notice. There's a 2-5-1 pretty much every bar, you know. So that's a little more dense. Blue Bossa, for instance, goes from the 1 chord to the 4 chord before it gets to its first 2-5-1. But still, there are 2-5-1s. That happens to be a minor 2-5-1, the first 2-5-1 that occurs in Blue Bossa. And then we get out to with the tonality of the song in the B section shifts up a half step from a C minor sound to a D flat sound, and we head to that D flat with a 2-5. Going to D flat before we resolve back to our C minor, our tonal center. So it's those similarities, and those you can look through and listen to. More importantly, I would recommend you listen to rather than read and look through things. You can listen to so many standards and start to hear that. Whether you're playing a blues, which is based a 12, but the basic kind of form, I guess the most popular form that people know is based around a 1 chord, a 4 chord, and a 5 chord. And then you get the kind of jazz changes, not the Charlie Parker bebop changes, first of all. I wouldn't recommend going there immediately, which are quite a big series of 2-5-1s, but the kind of the jazz changes on a regular blues. If you're an F, that involves going from the 1 chord to the 4 chord, and then a 2-5-1 to the 4 chord. I often put that in. So C minor 7, F 7, going to the 4 chord. And then when you get back up to the 1 chord, and there's another 2-5-1, A minor 7 flat 5 to D 7. So the main two of the overall tonal center, G minor 7 to C 7. And then you have options. You can go 1-6-2-5 or 3-6-2-5 or any number of different substitutions. You can go 1-flat-3-2-flat-2-1. There are all kinds of extracurricular, kind of fancy, expensive sounding turnarounds that you can use. But one of the first things I would do if you're not used to playing this material is perhaps look at the form of a jazz blues, where those 2-5-1s are falling. One of my things is, even in Blue Bossa, the first couple of chords to Blue Bossa are C minor to F minor 7, and then D minor 7 flat 5 to G 7 to the 1. And I'll just leave it like that for now. I'll stop the looper. In fact, one of the things I'm always trying to do, something I've done as an exercise quite a bit, and something that just appears naturally in my playing now, is it's a 1 chord going to a 4 chord. But to get to the 4 chord, you could play a 5, or however you want to voice it, going to make the 4 chord your new 1 tonal center. So the chord changes could actually be C minor 7, to C7. Now, those aren't the changes of the song, but that's something else you can superimpose, and that's something that's quite common throughout jazz vocabulary. So these are just extra options and commonalities between songs, and something, like I said, that I will use when I'm soloing, when I'm playing melodically over that. So instead of just playing C minor to, what I'm actually playing is C minor 7, and then you'll hear me, I'm using an E natural, I'm outlining a C7 chord to get to my F minor, so something like this. And even then, it's only C minor at the end, and then 1 is C minor again, but I put a G7 sound in there even though the chord isn't being played or isn't written. So there are all these kind of extra little details that occur in the music. These are things that you're going to hear the more you listen to this repertoire, and these are things that can really add interest to your playing. If you're playing this repertoire, and if you want to get better at this repertoire. And basically this whole 12-week course is kind of based around my experience of hearing all this stuff and the journey I took and the path I took to get to where I am now, to have the ability and the fluency and the fluidity in my playing over this kind of material. So I hope you can come and join us. Like I said, if you click the link below, we're running a special offer. We get with discounting a quarterly membership to the site all week long. Like I said before, don't forget to subscribe to the channel, because I'm always putting these videos up. So if joining isn't your cup of tea, that's all good. I really enjoy putting these videos up just to help people who want to take a little snippet of something, who are perhaps not ready to delve into an entire 12-week course and just want one or two small ideas to work on. These videos are absolutely for you. So please enjoy them. I will try and make them as frequently as my schedule allows. But for now, I'm Janek Gwizdala, videobasedlessons.tv. Click the link below, subscribe to the channel over here, and I'll see you again on the next lesson.